Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ganesha Upadhyaya. I'm a PhD student in the Department of Computer Science at Iowa State University. I'm going to present my work on effectively mapping abstractions to thread in message passing concurrency based on Java virtual machine. So before I start my talk, I would like to know how many of you programmed using message passing systems, like actors? We have quite a good number of people. Okay. So this work is done in collaboration with my advisor, Dr. Hadesh Rajan. So in this talk, we have two key takeaway points. First one is that local computation and communication behaviors of concurrent entity can help predict its performance, and we can have a modular and static technique for doing such, for solving this problem. So to illustrate the problem, consider a message passing system that contains a number of concurrently running entities that communicate only via message passing. So given that system, how do we map the concurrent entities to underlying architecture that contains multiple cores? So in case of JVM-based MPC systems, this problem has two parts. First, mapping concurrent entities to JVM threads and scheduling JVM threads to CPU cores. Fortunately, OS scheduler takes care of the second problem of scheduling the JVM threads. So in this work, I'm going to talk about a technique, static technique that maps MPC abstractions to JVM thread. Often, concurrency is the main concern while you perform the mapping, such that in your concurrent system, you do not face any data race, deadlock, or starvation, such issues. But addressing concurrency concerns not always may or may not give you the performance benefits. So in this technique, we show that we can achieve the performance by also satisfying concurrency concerns. Unfortunately, these abstractions to threads mapping have to be done by the programmers. For that, many widely known MPC systems provide schedulers and dispatchers using which you can perform this mapping. Here I am showing some of the popular JVM-based MPC systems. For example, Akka provides four different kinds of dispatchers, whereas Scala actors provide two different types of schedulers. So availability of such a wide variety of schedulers and dispatchers suggests us that programmers can choose the one that best suits their application. However, they have to be very careful while performing this mapping or scheduling their concurrent entities. And programmers find it hard to do this mapping manually, and they end up choosing the initial mapping and iteratively fine-tune their mapping such that they come to their desired performance. This process can really become tedious and time-consuming. And many discussions in open source forums like Stack Overflow suggest that random tweaking without knowing the root cause of the problem may not help. And for doing this mapping, one has to really know the nature of the task performed by the concurrent entities. Without that, just randomly, one cannot perform this mapping. So given that manual tuning is hard, programmers can try to use the default mapping. However, there is a problem that there is no single default mapping that works best across different applications. To illustrate the problem, consider two applications here, logistic map and scratchpad, where logistic map computes a recurrence relation. Both of these are MPC applications, and scratchpad just performs line of count operation. So here I'm showing the performance of four different default mapping techniques across different code settings. And for logistic map, we can see that round-robin default technique outperforms all the other techniques. So we have a clear single winner here. However, for scratchpad, it's not the case. On two core setting, random default strategy works better. And on 4 and 12, thread-based strategy works better. And for 8 core settings, worst stealing works better. So we can conclude that there is no single default strategy that programmers can initially use on different applications. So given that, why not we try a brute force technique that enumerates all possible mapping? But there is a problem of combinatorial explosion here. to illustrate, consider an example of MPC program with 8 kinds of abstraction. If you want to try out 4 different schedulers, you may end up exploring over 65,000 different combinations, and some of them may not even produce concurrency correct results. And also, if you have a small change in your program, then you may end up redoing the whole mapping. So in such scenarios, it is desirable to have a mapping, automatically generate a mapping that performs better than the default mapping. So that's what our solution is going to be. So these are a few of the key ideas that helps us to build the solution. First one is that local computation and communication behavior is predictive of determining the globally beneficial mapping. So what do we mean by computation and communication behaviors? The behaviors such as externally blocking behavior, the local state of the concurrent entity, computational workload involved in the concurrent entity, or message send receive patterns, etc. And we also observe that determining these behaviors at coarse or abstract level is sufficient to solve the mapping problem. We do not really require very high precision when we estimate these behaviors. So to give an outline of the solution, we first, given an MPC program, we first represent the computation and communication behaviors that I previously mentioned, and we perform a set of local program analysis to determine those behaviors. And we supply that behaviors to a mapping function that produces an execution policy. So here, execution policy describes how messages received by the concurrent entity are processed. You can see that by assigning different execution policies, one can achieve different abstractions to thread mapping. So I'm going to go over the execution policy in detail later. So to explain the solution better, I'd like to introduce an MPC framework called Panini capsules. In this, the concurrent entities are called capsules, and the capsules communicate via message passing, and the message handlers are equivalent to procedures in Panini capsules. So capsule here may contain a set of states and set of procedures. Here, the code snippet is showing a capsule ship that contains 2 states, local states, and 4 different procedures. So if ship receives messages, then one of these procedures will be executed. So given that capsule contains state and procedures, we perform a number of static analysis on each of these capsule procedures to determine their behaviors. And then we perform or combine these behaviors of the capsule procedures to form behaviors for the capsule. And then we supply those behaviors to a mapping function to get the execution policy. Let's see how we represent the behaviors that I described previously. We do that by using what we call capsule characteristics vector. This has 6 fields for representing different behaviors. Note that all of these behavior except local state is defined for both capsule procedures and capsules. And a local state is directly defined for capsules. So there is no behavior for procedures. So to go over the behaviors one by one briefly, blocking behavior basically represents externally blocking behavior due to I/O socket or database permit. And it can be assigned 2 values, true or false. The code snippet shows here an example blocking behavior using a system input stream where the program waits for the input from the user. And our may block analysis basically tries to see if the capsule procedure has any such blocking library calls by using the dictionary that contains all possible blocking library calls in Java APIs. Local state is also represented as behavior, where local state is composed by a set of variables. And local state can have 3 different values, nil, fixed, or variable, where nil means there is no local state in the capsule. And fixed means the local state can be determined statically. And for variable, it cannot be determined statically. It is varying in dynamically. So state analysis tries to check the different types of these state variables to determine to which class it belongs to. So next behavior is inherent parallelism. When capsule communicate with other capsules, it may expose different kinds of inherent parallelism. For example, when it communicates synchronously, the capsule may wait for the result of the communication. When it communicates asynchronously, it may not wait for the result, and it may also wait for the result and consume that result in later stage. So based on that, we assign three different values. The inherent parallelism analysis tries to look for different call claim pairs in the capsule procedure, and based on that, it assigns the value. Computational workload is also a behavior that represents the computations performed by the capsule. And we categorize them into math or IO, where math indicates that capsule performs more computation than waiting or communicating. For IO represents the otherwise. The computation workload analysis tries to compute the computation summary that consisting of recursive calls, high-cost libraries, unbounded loops, and such such functions that indicates computation-intensive nature in capsule. Both communication patterns such as send and receive are also represented as behaviors, where send can be assigned leaf, router, or scatter, where leaf represents no outgoing communications. Router represents one-to-one communication, and scatter represents batch communication. So similarly, receive pattern, it can be assigned gather, indicating that a capsule or a concurrent entity is going to receive more messages than it is going to send. And we assign request reply for the other case. For determining the communication pattern, we first look at the capsule procedure and compute what we call communication summary that contains all the statement except statements that are only related to send and receive communication or state read write. And an analysis takes this communication summary and produces the tuple, message send and receive patterns. So given that we have represented behaviors of capsule procedures, an important part is how do we combine these behaviors of capsule procedures to form behaviors for the capsule. So this is performed by behavioral composition. And for instance, a capsule has a blocking behavior if any of its procedure has a blocking behavior. So key idea here in the behavior composition is that capsule has a behavior, or its behavior is predominantly defined by the procedure that executes often. So concurrent entity, if it receives one kind of a message often, its behavior is defined by that nature of the message handler for that message. So that's the key idea there. So I have defined how do we represent the behavior and compute the behavior. Let's look at a few of the execution policies that can be assigned. In this work, we looked at four different execution policies: thread, task, sequential, and monitor, where in case of thread policy, every capsule or concurrent entity will be assigned a dedicated thread. That thread will process all the messages from that capsule. In case of task, it is assigned to a task pool where a shared thread will execute the messages. And in case of sequential and monitor, the thread that is calling the procedure itself will execute the behavior. So you can see here that by assigning different execution policies, we achieve different abstraction or capsules to thread mapping. So that's the idea there. So we have defined now execution policy. Let's see how our mapping function takes the capsule behavior and produces the execution policy. So our mapping function relies on a set of mapping heuristics listed in the table. So these heuristics tries to encode several intuitions about the MPC abstractions. For example, blocking heuristic states that if a capsule performs externally blocking behavior, then it must be assigned thread execution policy. What is the rationale there? Rationale is that if you assign some other policy, it may block the executing thread and result in system deadlock or starvation. So similarly, all the other heuristics have a goal that it assigns an execution policy such that it reduces the mailbox contention, message passing overhead, and message processing overhead, and possibly cache misses. So that is the goal of these forming these heuristics. So we encode these heuristics in the form of a decision diagram. You can see that this diagram is complete and it assigns a single execution policy. It takes a capsule C vector or a behavior vector as input and produces an execution policy. To evaluate our approach, we have considered 15 different benchmark programs from a variety of languages and sources such as Scala, Akka, etc. These programs exhibit different kinds of parallelism, by the way. And we compare our C vector-based mapping against four widely known default mapping strategies: thread, task. In task, we have round robin and random, and then we have work stealing. And we measure execution time and CPU consumption and to compare our approach. And our results show considerable improvement. Here, for every program, I'm showing on x-axis different core settings, 2, 4, 8, and 12. And on y-axis, I'm showing percentage execution time improvement. And for each core setting, we have four bars indicating percentage execution time improvement of our C vector-based mapping against four default mapping strategies. So higher the bar is better. So overall, we achieved 12 of 15 programs that showed good improvement, on average about 40 to 45% improvement. And three programs did not show any improvement. These are based data parallel applications, in which case it's easy to map the concurrent entities, and they do not fit well with the message passing system mechanisms. So to further analyze our result, we categorized our result into three categories. So these categories are formed based on the intuition, like why do we see the performance? So the first category says in these programs we see the performance improvement because of reduced mailbox contention. So similarly for second category, we see the improvement due to reduction in message passing and processing overheads. So to talk about applicability, we have tested or applied our technique to Panini capsules, and we also as a proof of concept tried to port this technique to Akka framework. And we saw similar results, which supported that our technique can be applicable to general MPC frameworks. There are a number of related works that tries to map actors or tasks directly to codes. However, these techniques are not directly applicable to JVM-based actor or MPC frameworks, and also they are not automatic in nature. So to conclude my talk, I have introduced a technique for performing the abstraction through thread mapping, and I've shown evaluation results on both Panini and Akka, two MPC systems. So with that, I'd like to conclude my talk, and thank you for attending my talk, and I'm open for any questions you may have.